Catherine, whom everyone called Kathy. Kathy idolized her brother. The two children became inseparable. And as Tom grew into a quiet, serious young man, his sister became an adventurous, freckle-faced tomboy. The Hepburns eventually had four more children who were encouraged to speak their minds, and Kathy learned to hold her own.
I mean, around the dinner table, around whatever, they said whatever they thought, whatever they believed. It was very important that you expressed yourself, and by God, she expressed herself.
Mrs. Hepburn was active in the suffrage movement, leading the Connecticut fight to win voting rights for women. Kathy frequently accompanied her mother, passing out brochures and marching in parades. Mrs. Hepburn eventually turned down an offer to run for the U.S. Senate. The Hepburns were leaders in radical causes, causes which were not popular in conservative Hartford. Neighbors threw bricks through their windows, and the children were frequently forced to defend themselves in fights.
I think it made me determined. It gave me a nice big chip on my shoulder, so I thought, God damn it, I'm gonna go out and mount something.
The Hepburns kept a summer home in Fenwick, an exclusive shorefront community in southern Connecticut. The beach house became a gathering place for the entire extended family, Hepburns, Houghtons, and friends. Athletic pursuits filled the summer days, days spent swimming, sailing, and playing in the ocean.
We were like a Chekhov play. You know, it was great. We kept meaning to go to Hartford, but we never did. All summer long.
In the spring of 1921, 12-year-old Kathy and her older brother Tom set off to visit their godmother in New York. On the morning they were to return home, Tom did not appear for breakfast.
Kate said, well, I'll go up and call him. He must have been sleeping. She goes up to his room, and at first when she opened the door, she didn't see him. What she saw was a curtain hanging loose because the curtain tie had been taken off of it. And then she saw the shadow come in front of her. And she turned around, and there was Tom. And he had hung himself with the curtain tie from the rafter of this room.
Tom was dead, his feet curled beneath him, clearly able to reach the floor. He had forced his own strangulation. Mrs. Hepburn heard the news at home in Hartford.
Well, I was sitting in the dining room, and the call came over the phone that Tom had died, and Mother just slumped on that table. And moments later, she regained her composure. And she never talked about it again.
Dr. Hepburn refused to believe his son's death was a suicide. He announced to the press that Tom had died while practicing a stunt, a fake hanging staged for effect. Her brother's death had a profound effect on Kathy. For the next 3 years, she withdrew and became nervous, suspicious, solitary. She refused to go to high school and finished her education at home. She even adopted Tom's birthday, November 8th, as her own. Kathy tried to take her brother's place in the family. She finally left home in 1924 to go to college in Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania. Although Kathy adopted a new name, Kate, she kept her antisocial behavior. Unpopular with her classmates, she was failing miserably by the end of her sophomore year. In the summer of 1926, out of the blue, The quiet, withdrawn young woman shocked everyone and announced that she was going to become an actress.
Kate came in, and the way she does with ideas, dropped this one like a bombshell. And I don't think Dad was even suspecting it, but Kate said she was going into the theater. And Dad hit the ceiling. He said, well, you know, you don't get anywhere in the theater unless you sleep with the director.
Her father sent her back to Bryn Mawr in the fall. By the spring of 1928, Kate's grades had improved enough for her to participate in the school's May Day celebration. She appeared in a school play and eventually went on to do roles in several more student productions. In her senior year, Kate met 28-year-old Ludlow Ogden Smith, whom she called Luddy. Luddy lived near the campus and belonged to a social group that appealed to Kate.
Luddy came from a blue blood Philadelphia family. He was very charming, rather effete looking, but a bit of a, had a matinee idol profile, you know, very, 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 very good looking. And Luddy adored Kate.
Kate graduated from Bryn Mawr and set out for New York to become an actress. By the end of that year, Luddy proposed, Kate accepted, and the couple were married. In New York, Kate immediately attracted attention, more for her style than her acting. Dressed in casual clothes and adopting a free-spirited personality, she became a regular in nightclubs and cultivated a position in cafe society.
Kate was certainly not your typical young actress trying to make her way on the stage. She came in thinking star from the very beginning. She never could see herself in a position of being in the background or being in the chorus or being whatever.
Kate began to land a series of acting jobs in the New York theater, but her lack of training and an outspoken attitude had an effect. In just 2 years, Kate was fired from four productions during rehearsals, never making it to opening night.
Well, I think, like many, many unique actresses who bring something fresh to the theater, she had a difficult time having that recognized. She was different, and if one is different, it's difficult for people around to accept that easily. They have to get used to it.
Kate did make it to Broadway in 1932, playing an Amazon queen in The Warrior's Husband. Wearing a costume that accentuated her long legs, Hepburn leaped down a flight of stairs with a stag slung over her shoulder.
She took this stag, she threw it onto the ground, and then her leading man was standing right there, and she jumped in and she wrestles him to the ground. And it was astounding. I mean, no one ever saw a woman do anything like that on stage.
Sweet dear, sweet dear.
Tell me goodbye.
No.
Yes, I feel you have to.
Hollywood took notice. Director John Ford made this screen test of Kate, but nothing came of it.
Oh, sweet heaven. What a world.
Then George Cukor ordered a test. Kate directed it herself.
And I had made myself up with true modesty. I'd never done it before, and fixed my own hair with my usual modesty, and picked the material. And I put a glass down, and George said the acting was idiotic, but you put a glass down and listened with great tenderness and emotion. And I was hired.
Cukor offered her the lead in his new film, A Bill of Divorcement, and soon Kate Hepburn, Broadway actress, was on her way to Hollywood to become Katharine Hepburn, movie star.
I hope.
From the Emmy-winning series,
She was just determined to be not just an actress, but an actress and a great star. And her life had gone in another direction from Luddy's.
In a bill of divorcement, Kate played Sydney Fairfield, a young Englishwoman who learns of her father's descent into madness and renounces her own happiness to stand by him. John Barrymore played her father. Producer David O. Selznick constantly worried about Kate's performance during filming. He was convinced she would be a flop.
She was quite different and odd-looking and beautiful and eccentric and, as a person, wildly sort of independent. I don't think they'd ever seen anything quite like her.
George Cukor, the film's director, soon became great friends with Hepburn. He felt he saw something special in the brash young actress.
He saw in Kate immediately a quality that he had seen in many of the other great stars that he had directed. Greta Garbo, Joan Crawford, a lot of these stars. He saw this quality of this unusual, strong-willed woman.
The public agreed.
You can't stand even the first glimpse of the truth. Darling, it would be dangerous for me to marry.
When a bill of divorcement opened, audiences fell in love with Hepburn, and so did the critics.
She told him she loves him. I heard her.
You mustn't.
I'm done with her. Get them out, I tell you. Get them out.
You mustn't let yourself go like this.
At once, or I'll kill it.
Kate's performance earned her a long-term contract with RKO. She followed her debut with Christopher Strong, the story of a daring aristocratic aviatrix. During filming, she began an affair with her agent, Leland Hayward. Hayward was married and a well-known ladies' man.
He looked a little bit like some of those sophisticated cartoons in the 1920s in the New Yorker and so forth. He was very intelligent, extremely charming, and on top of which, he was an agent, and he believed in her.
Kate continued her flirtation with Hayward and kept her marriage a secret. Luddy patiently waited for her to return to New York, convinced that her affair with Hayward and her career in Hollywood would soon be over. But Hollywood was enamored with Kate. Her uncharacteristically gentle performance in Morning Glory, only her third film, won her the Academy Award in 1933. She followed that with a dazzling performance in Little Women. Kate stunned audiences by creating a perfect image of a modern, independent woman. In late 1933, riding high on her film successes, Kate prepared for a triumphal return to Broadway. She chose a play called The Lake, directed by legendary producer Jed Harris. Harris was known for his cruel treatment of leading ladies, and his handling of Hepburn was no exception. Her performance was a famous disaster.
I walked through the opening night in a state of absolute paralyzed terror. And I kept praying, kill me, Lord, just kill me. Strike me dead, strike me dead. And nothing happened. I just went on the way you do, you know, and finally the curtain came down and everybody clapped and didn't mean it, in sorrow. And I was almightily roasted.
Kate's performance was roasted. Well-known wit Dorothy Parker commented, Miss Hepburn's emotions ran the gamut from A to B. The Lake lasted 55 performances. When Jed Harris announced his intention to take the show on the road, a horrified Kate offered to buy her way out. Harris took every cent she had and closed the play. Kate's public humiliation in New York only made her more determined to succeed in Hollywood.
She was tough, and she just wanted to be better, better, better. And if you told her she couldn't do something, she wanted to do it.
Kate's sudden lack of success extended to her marriage. She announced her plan to divorce Luddy and marry Leland Hayward. After a quick divorce in Mexico, she returned to California. Her relationship with Hayward eventually broke off. And more trouble followed. RKO cast Kate in a succession of historical costume pictures, which flopped at the box office. The studio failed to capitalize on the unique modern personality that made her a star.
A&E.
It wasn't this good.
Fort Hughes, the eccentric millionaire aviator, pursued Kate with style. He eventually won her over with extravagant stunts, once landing his small plane on a golf course to join her in a game. Hughes fascinated Hepburn.
Howard Hughes had a very brilliant mind, but he had something much more important than that, and that is that he never gave up. He went after what he got, and I always used to say if he went after a needle in a haystack in China, he'd find it. He would never give up. Wonderful quality. I copied it.
But Kate's perseverance was not the problem. Her pictures were. Her stock was falling at RKO. Stage Door, made in 1937, was originally intended as a Hepburn vehicle. But the studio added fast-rising star Ginger Rogers to the cast as box office insurance.
Don't think I intended to borrow it or anything. I just wanted to see how I'd feel in one of these things.
Do you feel very different?
I'll see.
Well, why don't you wear it?
Do you mean it?
Oh, why not? You may as well go to petition in Ermine. You're sure to come back in rags.
Well, what right you come breaking into my private office?
Why would you barricade yourself behind closed doors and refuse to see people?
Hepburn turned in a great performance as a society girl actress cut down to size by her roommates in a theatrical boarding house. Stage Door proved to be another box office flop. Bringing Up Baby with Cary Grant was hailed as her best performance to date. The picture lost $365,000. A lot of money in 1937. RKO finally lost faith in Hepburn and began to loan her out to other studios. Kate knew her time was up when she was offered a B picture called Mother Carey's Chickens. She decided to part company with RKO and bought out her contract. The same day, theater owners ran ads in trade papers labeling Hepburn box office poison. And when she approached David O. Selznick for the role of Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind, the producer of many of her hits turned her away. After 15 films in 6 short years, her career seemed over. With no prospects, Kate left Hollywood and returned home to Connecticut. But Katharine Hepburn was never one to give up. More determined than ever, she began to search for the role that would put her back on top. In 1938, Katharine Hepburn was living at her family home on the seashore in Fenwick, Connecticut. Her days in Hollywood were over, despite an Academy Award and worldwide fame.
Her career seemed to be at a standstill at this particular time. No one was really rushing to send any scripts to Katharine Hepburn.
That year, Howard Hughes set a record by circling the world in a twin-engine plane. More than 1 million people watched a parade in his honor in New York. Kate joined him, and together they played a game of hide-and-seek with the press.
Well, for a person who really wanted to live a private life, Kate was always attracted to the kind of men and the kind of situations that would create the most press. And certainly, Howard Hughes was that kind of a person.
Howard proposed to Kate in New York, but the idea fizzled out, as Kate put it, and Hughes returned to the West Coast in late 1938. Kate remained at Fenwick. In September, a ferocious hurricane struck the Connecticut coast. The beloved Hepburn house was literally washed away. In the aftermath, Kate and her family picked through the rubble and only managed to retrieve a few dishes and trinkets. Dr. Hepburn immediately built a new, larger home on the beach. By the end of that year, Kate finally thought she'd found her comeback script. Her friend, Philip Barry, finished a play based on the Hepburn family. He called it The Philadelphia Story. The leading role of rich society girl Tracy Lord was written specifically for Hepburn. When the play opened on Broadway in early 1939, Kate desperately needed a hit to reestablish her career.
A friend of George Cukor's came to the opening night and he said, "Oh, I hope Kate doesn't come on and be sweet. I hope she's rude to everyone." And I came on and I was rude to my mother about all the wedding presents I'd been given. And he was delighted. And it went well. Lucky.
He had everything Hollywood
was a smash. And to ensure her return to Hollywood, Kate convinced Howard Hughes to loan her the money to buy the film rights.
I bought the play, The Philadelphia Story, when it opened, because I'm practical. You see, I have common sense, and I knew that all those beautiful, successful Hollywood ladies would want it. And I thought if I owned it, they couldn't have it. And eventually it was so good that they'd finally have to have me with it.
Kate succeeded in her plan, making a deal with MGM's Louis B. Mayer. She asked for Spencer Tracy and Clark Gable to co-star with her. Mayer offered Cary Grant and Jimmy Stewart.
To get a star is extremely difficult. To get two stars is twice as hard. And to get three stars is almost unheard of. I mean, what pictures are made even today that have three important stars? Very few. But she engineered all that because she knew that it would be good.
What is this, Connor?
Oh, easy, easy, old man. She's not hurt?
No, no.
Not wounded, Saul, but dead.
Seems the minute she hit the water, the wine hit her.
Now, look here, Connor. A likely story, Connor.
Hello, Dexter. Hello, George. Hello, Mike.
Katharine Hepburn made her movie comeback in The Philadelphia Story. The picture made almost $1.5 million and received six Oscar nominations, including one for Kate.
Suddenly, she was a brand new star in Hollywood, really, because the role in Philadelphia Story set up Kate in a different mold. She was now a different personality. One saw the strength, and we saw, as well, the arrogance.
I used to be afraid of that look, the withering glance of the goddess.
I didn't think that alcohol would shut up.
Kate grabbed control of her career, and in 1941, she acquired a story called Woman of the Year. She wanted and got Spencer Tracy to co-star in the romantic comedy as the rough, down-to-earth sports writer to her temperamental, sophisticated journalist. The deal cemented her reputation as a tough businesswoman.
She usually got anything she wanted because she would turn up wearing the traditional slacks and she'd barge into their offices and give them hell.
Kate had never met Spencer. She ran into him on the MGM lot before filming began.
And so she said to Spencer, "Oh, Mr. Tracy, I'm afraid I'm going to be a bit tall for you." And Tracy answered back, "Don't worry, Miss Hepburn, I'll cut you down to size."
The exchange set the tone for the film. On the set of Woman of the Year, Tracy glared at Hepburn, flustering the usually unflappable actress. But on film, the two caught fire. Their on-screen chemistry was magnetic, and within weeks, the studio was buzzing with rumors of an off-screen romance. The team of Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn was box office magic, and a legendary love affair was about to begin. The success of Woman of the Year established Spencer Tracy and Katharine Hepburn as a team, on screen and off. From the beginning, Kate adored Spencer. Tracy was Catholic, married, and the father of two children, but he and his wife Louise had not lived together for years. Their son Johnny was deaf, which only fueled Tracy's Catholic guilt.
It's no secret to the world that Spencer was a drinker. And I think, having been close to him at the time, that a great deal of that came as a result of his deep, deep unhappiness about his son's unhappiness.
With Spencer, Kate was submissive. She let him take the lead in everything. Family and friends were surprised. Kate was no longer the fiercely independent woman they all knew.
I often felt that she was submerging herself to him. I think, too, that Spencer was sort of a younger edition of her father in her mind. I think she admired his ruggedness.
Kate began to turn down work to be near Spencer. For a while, her only appearances were in Tracy Hepburn films, and their on-screen partnership was sizzling. Keeper of the Flame, Without Love, and State of the Union established them as the movie's top twosome. Kate's success, tragedy struck the Hepburn family when Kate's mother died of a cerebral hemorrhage. Kate's father eradicated all record of his wife's existence. Kate threw herself into work and set off to star in The African Queen. She became a great friend and admirer of her co-star, Humphrey Bogart, and his wife, Lauren Bacall. And Kate adored working with director John Huston, who helped her find the key to portraying Rose Sayre.
I remember one of her memories of John Huston was the greatest bit of directing she ever had was when he came in and said, "You're looking so damn depressed. Smile. Think of Eleanor Roosevelt."
I never dreamed that any mere physical experience could be so stimulating.
I'm the captain, that's who. I ain't taking you along. You'd only be in my way.
I suppose I was in your way going down the rapids. Then what you said to me back there on the river was a lie about how you never could have done it alone and how you lost your heart and everything. You liar.
Hepburn's performance in The African Queen was a landmark in her career. She earned an Oscar nomination for a role that combined her trademark strength with obvious vulnerability.
You promised you'd go down the river.
There's death a dozen times over down the river.
You promised.
Well, I'm taking my promise back.
Kate followed her triumph in The African Queen with Pat and Mike. Garson Kanin and Ruth Gordon tailored the story for Tracy and Hepburn. Kate's role was designed to show off her athletic abilities.
So, well, there's one thing only about us hooking together that's what I call a plenty long shot.
Nothing wrong with a long shot.
If you come out on top, that's a fact.
We will, Mike.
By 1955, the years of heavy drinking caught up with Spencer Tracy. His health was failing.
With the alcoholism also came various other health problems. Heart, kidney, various other problems. And Tracy became quite ill. Kate was most attentive. She really became his muse, his help, his nurse, his just about everything that you can possibly think of. She really devoted herself to Tracy at this point and got him through.
At the same time, her father's health was also deteriorating, and Kate was at his side when he died on November 20th, 1962. Although Spencer had been ill for over a decade, Kate and director Stanley Kramer persuaded him to try one more film. In 1967, they began shooting Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, the story of a couple whose daughter brings home a black fiancé. Kramer, Hepburn, and Tracy placed their salaries in escrow to ensure the completion of the film.
There was a great deal of doubt on everyone in everyone's mind whether Tracy would be able to cope with a film schedule, with the toughness of the film schedule. Got sicker and sicker as the film progressed. They had to shoot his scenes between 9 and 12 in the morning. He wasn't able to go any further than that.
And for what it may be worth, I'm going to be on her side.
The old Tracy Hepburn magic was there for all to see.
Well, I never would have believed I'd hear you say a thing like that.
Can I get you another drink?
No, thanks. I'll get it myself.
With Kate at his side, Spencer turned in a fine performance.
The only thing that matters is what they feel and how much they feel for each other. And if it's half of what we felt, that's everything.
On June 10th, 1967, 3 weeks after the film was finished, Spencer Tracy died. For 2.5 decades, the couple kept their relationship private. Out of respect for Spencer's wife and family, Hepburn did not attend the funeral.
She never talked about his going at all, which is a curious thing. It's almost like my mother's attitude towards Tom's death. Don't talk about it. Go to work, you know. Do something.
Katharine Hepburn did something indeed. She won a second Oscar for her work in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner and accepted the award in Spencer's name. At the age of 60, she began another era in a career that already spanned 3.5 decades. And in her new career, she would establish herself as more than a movie star. Katharine Hepburn was on her way to becoming a legend. The year Spencer Tracy died. At 60, an age when many female stars have trouble finding roles, Kate found herself playing parts as dynamic as she was. In The Lion in Winter, Kate co-starred with Peter O'Toole, a well-known tyrant on the movie set. He met his match in Kate. From the outset, the two strong-willed actors enjoyed an adversarial relationship.
Do you truly care who's king?
I care because you care so much.
Don't fight me, Eleanor.
What would you have me do? Give out, give up, give in?
Give me a little peace.
A little? Why so modest? How about eternal peace? Now there's a thought.
Kate's performance won her a third Academy Award. Director Anthony Harvey accepted the statue for Kate.
I called her up from Hollywood. I think it must have been about 3 a.m, about 7 o'clock her time. She said, oh God, really? And I said, well, aren't you thrilled? Oh, come on, Tony. Put it in a paper bag somewhere. 3 years later, I was sitting with her in the house. She opened the cupboard to get a box of chocolates or something, and there it was, still in the paper bag, totally forgotten about. It hadn't even been engraved.
In 1969, Kate was back on Broadway, this time in Coco, a musical based on the life of fashion designer Coco Chanel. Hepburn arrived on Broadway a full-fledged legend.
It was a classic example of not being able to take your eyes off her. She just took over the stage. She was magnificent.
Hip replacement surgery in the early 1970s did not slow her down, and Kate starred in a series of TV movies. And in 1980, she was back on Broadway one last time in West Side Waltz. Her legend could be intimidating for many co-stars, but Kate used humor to put people at ease.
When we first met and started rehearsing, she said to me, I'll call you Dot. Now, nobody calls me Dot. But, I mean, it sounded, oh, music to me when she said Dot, you know. And I said, she said, is that all right? And I said, yes, that's fine. And I said, well, what shall I call you? And she said, you may call me Miss Hepburn, which I thought. And then, of course, she laughed.
That same year, Kate starred in On Golden Pond with Henry Fonda. She quickly developed affection for her fellow movie legend. Early in the filming, she presented Fonda with one of Spencer's favorite hats, and Fonda wore it throughout the film. On Golden Pond was the story of a cantankerous old man who had given up on life, and his loving wife of 50 years who was determined to keep him alive.
You're my knight in shining armor. Don't you forget it. You're gonna get back on that horse, and I'm gonna be right behind you, holding on tight, and away we're gonna go, go, go.
I don't like horses.
Fonda won his only Academy Award for his portrayal and died soon after. Katharine Hepburn won an unprecedented fourth Oscar. In 1982, Kate severely injured her left foot in an automobile accident. The accident left her slowed but still busy. She continued to divide her time between Fenwick and her New York townhouse and made several more TV movies.
78 Baker, take three. Mark, action.
Is she late?
She's right on time.
I keep retiring and I don't stay there. I can't do it. I mean, I don't think you can say I'm not gonna work, or you can't say I'm going to work. Can you? You can't work unless you got something to do. And if you see something you want to do and you turn it down, you think, hoo-hoo.
An unconventional beauty who spoke her mind, she forever changed Hollywood and generations of women.
I think for women, she is a great champion of independence, standing up for what you believe in.
I think she brought a dignity to women's roles that hadn't been there before. She enabled many, many actresses that followed her. I don't think there could have been a Barbra Streisand without a Katharine Hepburn.
She's a very, very ambitious girl, and she's brave. She accepts any challenge that she herself thinks she can master.
One of her essential characteristics was independence. Yes, indeed. She does things her way.
I was born absolutely at the right time. And I'm gonna die not a moment too soon. You know. I mean, I think that's the story of me. Great timing.
Until her recent death, Katharine Hepburn continued to live in the family home on the Connecticut coast. In 1999, she was there doing her daily yoga routine when she got the news. The American Film Institute had named her the century's greatest female screen legend. Katharine Hepburn's final role came in a 1994 television movie called One Christmas. One of her lines in the film was written specifically for her. Quote, I can sit back in my old age and not regret a single moment, not wish to change a single thing. According to those who knew her, those were Katharine Hepburn's sentiments exactly. For A&E, I'm Harry Smith. Thanks for being with us.
Find that firearm.